Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Tonight, what we're going to do is we're going to get in. Oh, if you're here for the first time, someone said I need to do that. If you're here for the first time, too bad. We have a pamphlet for you. We'll give it to you later. And so let's get into the word of the Lord. No, I'm only playing with you. Anybody here for the first time? Nobody. See, there's some folks for the first time back there. We love you guys. Okay, we have a little pamphlet brochure. Anybody else, just raise your hand. There's some folks back there. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We love all the way to the back. All right, cool. We love you guys. You just have to understand my personality is a bit weird and not the traditional. Obviously, just looking at me, I'm not the traditional minister that you would normally come to church and see. There's no white collar. There's not even a suit. In fact, I remember one time years ago getting upset with one of our guest speakers because he didn't have a sport coat on. And well, I have really fallen into the summer pattern of Southern California, and this is the dress code for church from now on, and at least for me. And the rest of you, you wear shorts if you want. I could care less. And so we're going to get into the word of the Lord, and that's what's important, because it's not what's on the outside of a man, it's what's on the inside that God looks at. Has anybody got that? So we're going to Proverbs in the third chapter. Go there with me and let's take a look at Proverbs in the third chapter. And it's just dynamic. I wanted to spend some time just in review of last week quickly. I love verse number one of last week. And if you don't, we're not going to put this on the overhead, but it says, do not forget. He says, my son, don't you remember the intimacy? We'll talk about that in a moment. And he says, do not forget my law, my word, my ways, my will. We have a tendency to forget. Someone asked me after church, how do you not forget? I said, get into church. We'll remind you constantly. The more you're reminded, eventually it becomes part of your thinking. And you don't forget. You know, sometimes we're so far away from God, we forget about stuff all the time. We're humans. When God could heal us on one day, in a month, 2 months, 3 months later, we forgot about the healing power that touched us. God could bless us economically a few months later. We forget. God knows that, and that's why he starts right off this amazing chapter with do not forget. We don't need to be forgetful people, and if you don't want to be a forgetful person and you want to be a grateful, appreciative person, you've got to get into church all the time where they remind you about who God is and who you are with God. It's just about as simple as that. And all of a sudden, you start to learn things. You start to learn about the Word of God. You start to learn about the inside of God, the heart of God, the character of God, the nature of God. And as you come into church, you start to learn these things. Then you start to become a mature Christian, dealing with your kids a certain way, dealing with your husband or your wife a certain way, dealing with life, your finances, as you're finding out on Sundays, even as we get together. You learn how to deal with things instead of your way. You learn how to deal with them God's way. And that's what's really becoming neat, because when you start to do things God's way, there's a tremendous blessing. And God really wants to bless you. Is there a parent in here that doesn't want to see their children blessed? Every one of us want to see our children blessed on a regular basis, so it was really great to see that. He says, not mercy and truth in verse number 3. Forsake you, wrap them around your neck, hold them in the tablets of your heart, you know, and then he gives you something. He says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Remember this one, and lean not to your own understanding. But I thought the life-changing part of these verses that we went to last week was this part. And I love this part found in verse number 6. In all of your ways, acknowledge him. I mean, there's very few of us in this room, including Pastor Jim, including Pastor Luke, including Pastor Deborah, including Pastor, if you will, Dan, very few, Pastor Powell, very few, as even Dr. Kobernick, all of us would have to admit, in all of our ways, we probably do a lot of things because we're comfortable doing them and know how to do them. But the Bible says, in all of our ways, acknowledging him, and I love the next part of it because I need the direction of the Lord, and he will direct your path. I need to be on the right path to be at the right place. If you've got anybody got a GPS and it takes you on these goofy places, it's an old GPS system, and all of a sudden you're going through downtown LA when you could have taken a freeway to get there or whatever, or there's road wasn't built nowadays, and it's there, and everybody knows it's there for the last 5 years, but your GPS doesn't show it, and all of a sudden you're on the wrong road, ending up in the wrong place, taking a lot longer to get there. So, and if you're on the wrong path, you will take longer to get to where you need to be. But if you're on the right path, and he will direct your path, all because you do something. You acknowledge him in all of your ways. Before you express yourself, before you say anything, before you do anything, before you make a statement, before you make a decision, why not acknowledge God in all of your ways and let him direct your path? Because when he directs your path, you're in the road to prosperity, you're in the road of success and blessings. I love every bit of that. I love that it said in verse number 9, verse number 10, it said these words, honor the Lord with your possessions and the first fruit of all of your increase. How cool is that? In other words, we've been talking about that. Honor. Honor is an amazing word. Remember how we talked about it last week? I mean, set him up is very important, or the very most important thing. When you honor someone, you honor them, and you set them up as one of the most important things. And here God says, honor the Lord with something. He didn't say just honor the Lord with your heart, honor the Lord with your thinking, honor the Lord with your prayer. He makes a statement. He says, honor the Lord with your first possessions. And so all of a sudden he makes a statement and he says these words. If you'll do what he says, and listen to what it finally said from last week, so that your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine, you'll have prosperity. Now somebody needs to want prosperity. I mean, let's face it, guys. All of us probably are sick and tired of being broke. God's prosperity is not just money in your pocket. Let me say that to you again. God's prosperity, and you got to get off of thinking like this. God's prosperity is not just money in your pocket. God's prosperity, listen to this, is when your family's blessed and you're protected and you're delivered and, you know, the devourer doesn't get what you have planted. You find yourself in a place of being blessed in the city, in the field. Your marriage is good. Your kids are healthy. That's amazing life, and that's a blessed life. That's real prosperity. But he's not excluding the money in your wallet. He doesn't exclude that. He would like to prosper you that way too, because he wants you to share that around and also be in a blessed position. As we go to these next verses, they're really powerful, starting in verse number 11. So this, if you will, is God Speaks, part 3 of Proverbs, the 3rd chapter. Let's take a look at verse number 11. He starts off again with two familiar words, my son. Again, second time in 11 verses, he refers to an intimate relationship. God wants and has an intimate relationship with you. I mean, stop and think about it. One person said this to me a long time ago. They said, you know, no devil in hell ever paid the price for me, but Jesus paid the price for me. That makes him very special. That makes him, he can have me. He paid the price for me. There's no devil in hell ever paid the price for me. So why do you follow the devil? Why do you listen to the devil? Why do you listen to garbage and trash or things that are contrary to the ways of God? In other words, if he's got an intimate relationship with me, then I should have an intimate relationship with him. If he thinks of me and you as his child, then we ought to think of him as his, as our parent. We're the king's kids. We're the child of God. We're a born again. In our DNA is the Holy Spirit. We're not just losers, failures. We're not just people who don't have a hope. Yes, you may have made a mistake in the past, but God takes people who make mistakes and makes great heroes out of them all through the Bible. So that doesn't mean a thing because you've had a mistake in the past. Man, get up and go with God and watch God do something marvelous. So if God sees you as a child, you ought to see yourself as that child at least and have an intimate relationship with God. Two words, my son. Then he comes along, verse number 11. Do not, and these verses, verse 11, verse number 12, just like a thought out of the blue. It's like a random thought that came and it hits us. Two verses. I want to read the whole verses. I'm going to come back and explain it to you. Is that okay? And so he makes this statement. He says, my son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father, the son in whom he delights. I read that, and all of a sudden, you know, everybody wants the blessing, but nobody wants the correction. But what if the correction is as important on that road to get you to the blessings as anything you possibly imagine? In other words, if I'm off course and I need the direction of God, then God, please correct me. If I'm making a mistake, God, that keeps me from the blessings of the Lord, would you do something for me, God? Would you correct my ways so that I can be what you would have me to be, so I can receive the promises that you've given me? I don't want to stay out there. And you know, sometimes when God chastens us, when God corrects us, we don't like it. It's like a form, if you will, of some kind of discipline. And he does that. I find you probably think of about 30 different ways that God may do this, but may I share a few with you? Number one, you'll find that God disciplines us oftentimes by holding back. And he's not going to bless you when you're off track or out of order. And so he wants to bless you. So a lot of people say, well, if he wants to bless me, Pastor, then why doesn't he just bless me? Why doesn't he just bless me? If he wants to bless me, why? Because if he blesses you where you're at, you'll stay where you're at, off track. You'll think you're right, wouldn't you? If you got a blessing, you say, man, I must be doing the right thing. I'm going to stay in here with God. And it's not the right thing. It might be the right thing for this moment, this hour, this day, but a long-term, long relationship with God, it's the worst thing in the world. So God corrects us. And he does this sometimes by holding back. The other thing that I sensed is that he's silent. You know, there's times when God is just not going to speak to you about stuff. Like, for an example, I've got a business that I told you last week that I've started a couple years ago, and building alternative energy systems. And I told a lot of people that I'm just believing because of my connection with God that God's going to give me the amazing insight, or at least put me in touch with people that have amazing insight for energy systems in the future, because I believe the energy systems in the future will be a hundred times bigger than the internet ever was. And you know how much money's been made off the internet. Now I'm only interested, because at my age I can give a flip about money. I'm only interested in expanding and building the kingdom of God if it should be the will of God. Now, has God told me for sure this is going to happen? No, but I've got this down on the inside of me. He's really quite silent about it, to tell you the truth. It's not like he's coming along and say, okay, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this. He's really quite silent with me so that I do something in my life. And the correction is he wants to get me on the right path, so I've got to do something with my life. So here's what I do as a Christian. I know better. I knock, seek, and ask. And I'm just knocking and seeking and asking every old place I can do and everything I know how to do, going places that sometimes may even be frustrating, speaking to people about things. I just knock, seek, and ask until I hear this is the connection that you're supposed to have. And so being silent oftentimes is a form of correction. And he's not trying to be mean. He's not trying to be hard or harsh or anything like that. He's just trying to get your attention, to get you back on the right spot. Third thing I found out about the Lord when he disciplines and he chastens us oftentimes is that it's really quite interesting. He'll put pressure on us. He'll allow whatever forces are out there to put pressure on us. And sometimes we make dumb mistakes. Am I the only person I'll admit I ever made a dumb mistake? Or do I have any other truthful people? All the rest are liars that don't raise their hands. And that we'll cast the devil out of you right after the church service because you're a liar. And we've all made dumb mistakes. Is that not true? And so when he makes this statement here, he says these things. He says, I'm going to put some pressure on where you're at, what you're doing, so that you stop where you're at, what you're doing, and check it out. In fact, listen to this. Oftentimes, can I say this to you? The devil is controlled oftentimes. This is a really hard statement without really defining what I mean, so it doesn't mistake you. You have a mistaken understanding. But he's controlled by God. He does not control God, nor does he control you. In fact, it was God who let the pressure out on Job, and the devil just followed through. He says, listen, I'm going to pull the hedges down. He says, have you considered my servant Job? At the end of the book of Job, remember I told you the story? Job says, I have heard of you. I've heard of you with my ears, but now, through the whole experience, I see you. Man, now he has a relationship with God that's deep and meaningful. And all of it started when the devil was used. In fact, let me take you to the New Testament. Hold your place right there in Proverbs, the third chapter. Go with me, if you will, in 1 Peter, the fifth chapter. Watch this. And here's Peter writing. By the way, Peter's pastoring the church of Jerusalem when he's writing this. And he's writing to a very persecuted group of people in the fifth chapter, and he makes a statement. But I want to read to you verse number 6 of the fifth chapter of 1 Peter. Listen to what it says in verse number 6. Familiar words for you, if you've been around the Word of God for a while. But also you need to see how important they are. Verse number 6, therefore humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. There's a couple of things I wanted to point out to you. Notice it says humble yourself. You never want God to humble you. In other words, when things are there, you got the pressure on you, and you know things aren't going the way you think they ought to go, and you've been believing and standing and believing God, and you don't see any results, you know, and you might come to a conclusion where you say, well, maybe I better test where I'm really at to see if I'm doing what God would have me to do. And the way to do that is to humble yourself. Humble yourself means that you become very dependent. Humbling yourself comes, I'm dependent on God instead of on myself. So in other words, he says, here's a time you're going to take the back seat and let God have the front seat. You get out of the driver's seat of your life and let God take the wheel. And that's really difficult for us humans to do. We want to control everything. Have you ever been around a control freak? And they won't even stop talking. They tell you what to do all the time. And all of a sudden, here we take a look at this, and it makes it very clear that we're to humble ourselves. We're talking about demonic activity that put pressure on you. Watch this. Under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you. And I should have highlighted the words due time. In other words, you know, you're on this path going somewhere with God. Oftentimes, it's okay. We get off the path and we make mistakes. And God's going to put pressure on you to get you back on the right path in order to get blessed. So in due time, it's going to happen. It's not going to happen overnight, but in due time, verse number 7, it makes this statement. Cast all your cares upon him who cares for you. In other words, you're going to have to learn how to do this. This is not about you getting out of the problem, you getting out of the pressure, you getting out of the silence, getting into some expression by God. It's about trusting God and his timing. He's going to take care of you whenever that might be. Verse number 8 comes along. Verse 8 says this, but be sober and vigilant. And verse 8 is a fabulous word. Be sober means to be godly controlled life. In other words, if I have a godly controlled life, he says, be sober. And then he says, vigilant. He says, watch out where you're at. That's what that means. So now he comes along and tells me what to do. He says, I need a godly controlled life. Yes, I've got the pressure. Yes, I've got the trials. Yes, God doesn't seem to be speaking to me. I'm not quite sure. It's silent in this place. And I'm not quite sure. He's withholding what's going on. Am I on the right path? Am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing? It's not bad to check that, is it? You'll find that all through Scripture. Guess what it says? Because your adversary, the devil, walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. We know the verse very well. But verse 9 makes a statement that's fascinating. Resist him steadfast in the faith. So when the pressures come, you're going to have to stay in faith and do what? Resist him. Resist him. I'm not putting up with that. I'll make the changes. I'm not going to let that destroy me, my family, the thing. I'll make the changes. I'll get off that path that I'm on and get on the path that you're on. And remember what he said? He said these words, and they're wonderful words. He said, acknowledge the Lord in all of your ways, and he will direct your path. So as you start to acknowledge God, which means get out of the driver's seat and humble yourself, all of a sudden God will direct you his path, get you back in line, guess what, for the blessings. Now watch this. But I like the last part of this verse. I should have, from that, after the word faith, all the way to the end, I should have highlighted it. Knowing. There's sometimes we ought to know things. He says, knowing the same suffering are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. In other words, there's pressures, there's suffering, there's trials, there's silence, there's times that are going to come against you. You're going to make sure that you're on the right path. And if you don't feel you're on the right path, then humble yourself, cast your cares on he that cares for you, move on in your life, and expect God to do great, mighty, marvelous things. Somebody ought to give me a great big amen on that. Go back with me, if you will. In fact, now that I've read that verse, let me take you to Hebrews, which is a similar thing about God chastening us. You know, God corrects who he loves, like a father corrects. Doesn't say he abuses. If you had an abusive father, I'm sorry about that. Time to get over that one and hook up to the right one. The right one, his name is Jesus. And let me just share this with you. It's important. I remember when my father corrected me. In fact, let's just read this, and I'll give you an example of that in just a moment. It's really fascinating. In Hebrews, the 12th chapter. And go with me, if you will, in Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Let's take a look at... plop up that first verse. I don't even have it marked in my Bible. It says, and you have forgotten. Verse 5, thank you. Hebrews 12 chapter verse number 5. Oh, no wonder I was in verse number 11. 12 chapter verse number 5. And it says this, and you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. Let me tell you something. If you've got the pressure on you, it's not because you're bad. It's because God loves you, and he wants to get you into the right place. And the right place is the place of amazing blessings. I remember these verses that go on, and they're so important for us. He says, and whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. Then he makes this statement, verse number 7. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as a son. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening and without all that have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. I mean, that is powerful. God is making a statement that he says, I love you enough to correct you. Let me correct you. Don't let it bother you. Don't get frustrated, discouraged. Don't get down on yourself and think of yourself as one big world loser. That's not what this is all about. God sees you as his child. And when you love your children, you will make sure they're going in the right direction. You won't let them get off track. You won't let them get into the street. You won't let them get on a freeway. You would stop them. Their life would be at stake. Is that not true? Yeah. I remember my dad. He didn't understand the Bible. I led my dad to the Lord, but he was a good man. He did take me to church, but it was just a ritual. It was just religion. And he wasn't against God or anything like that. But when I got older, I led my dad to the Lord. But my dad was a tough guy. And when my brother and I had a four-year-old brother that's 4 years older than me, and when we would mess up in the house like kids do, Dad wouldn't take out the rod. He'd take his belt off. He was never abusive, ever abusive. But man, that belt stung like you can't imagine. And he never overdid it. He was always there. He was a dad, and I hated him for it. He would always say these words to me, and I hated these words. That was such a lie to me. He said, son, this is going to hurt me more than it does you. I never believed that at all. We had a house in those days that you could go from one room to the other. It was like a big giant. You could just one room float in another and go in a circle. And my brother and I would break lamps fighting and do what kids do and jumping from beds to beds. And he'd come in and mom say, you're going to get it when dad comes home. And I would pick mom up. I was a big boy. And I'd pick mom up and put her on top of the refrigerator. And she couldn't get down. And dad would come home. And he'd get so mad, he'd start chasing my brother Gary and I around all the time. And Gary, he'd say, look that way. If he comes that way, let me know. And I'll look this way and I'll let you know. And he would say, here he comes this way. And he'd be pushing on me and we'd be running. And we'd stop and dad'd say, here he comes this way. And we would run from dad. And then dad would make this statement. He made this statement to me many, many times in my life. He said, son, you guys better come and get this because you're not getting away from it. And you might as well take it like a man, because this is what you need. And I'm going to tell you something. He put some bruises on my butt that I hated. I hated him after he did that. But today, I can tell you, I thank God for a man who disciplined me in such a way that I could become with God and I could respect what God had to say when it came to chastening. Because the chastening, the actual discipline that God had for me, can I say this to you? Parents, some of you young parents don't discipline your children very much at all. The discipline that the Bible talks about in the scripture is discipline that works. God knows how to raise a family, and God knows how to raise kids. And may I say this to you? If you want your kids to serve the Lord, you ought to follow what the scripture says, and I promise you, they will come back to the things of God. Don't know when, but if they ever go, they'll come back. And that's what that's all about. So here he comes along and says, what you're going through right now is not something that's not common to man, which is 1 Corinthians also makes that statement. Go back with me, if you will, into Proverbs, because I want to finish in just a few minutes. The next few verses, and I'm not going to very many verses in Proverbs, but the next few verses are really powerful. Let's talk about them just for a moment. Verse 13. Happy is the man who finds wisdom and the man who gains understanding. In order to understand this, let's take a look at it. All of a sudden, the whole subject changes again. I love these because these are like nuggets of wealth. Let's take a look. It's kind of fun. Happy. I love this. Every time I go to Disneyland, I don't know about you. Some of the kids are happy. The grandkids are happy, but I'm not happy. That's all I do is say, come on, Grandpa, get on this ride. I ain't getting on that ride. I wouldn't get on that ride if I was 12. I don't want to get on that ride. But I'll sit here and watch the little ones. So I sit there, watch the little ones, eat too much of stuffed food that costs too much money, and stand in lines for an hour and a half that didn't have to be an hour and a half, but they're trying to wait. You know, something about Disneyland. Have you ever looked at the faces of the people, the happiest place on the earth? They don't look very happy in line at all. You want happiness. Happiness doesn't come from your Disneyland season pass. That happiness comes from Jesus Christ and a relationship with God. He says, happy is the man who finds wisdom. I love the word finds wisdom. I stopped and asked God. I said, God, what do you mean finds? See the word finds? Circle it in your Bible. It's really an interesting word. Who finds wisdom. Did you know wisdom that we're talking about is two types of wisdom in the world? There's the wisdom of the world, which most people and us that are in there have followed for most of our life. And then stop, look at me. There's the wisdom of God found in the scripture. And most of the time, we don't know the difference between the wisdom in the world and the wisdom of God. The wisdom of the world leads you to destruction. The wisdom of God leads you to blessing. Most of the time, we operate our life and take the path of the wisdom of men instead of the wisdom of God. Now, he makes a statement when he's talking about wisdom. He's not talking about the wisdom of men. I want to define that and clearly state that to you. He is talking literally about the wisdom of God. You say, wait a minute, I thought in James 1, first chapter, verse number 5, it says, ask God, who if you are in need of wisdom, he will liberally give it to you. Does it not say that? He will give you wisdom. Well, what's the difference between wisdom that you are given and wisdom that you find? And I remember this story when I was a young boy. Let me explain the difference. The difference is one is given to you for a moment. The other is settled in your heart. It belongs to you and you operate your life by it. Oh, watch this. So the wisdom you ask for, God will give you direction. But that doesn't mean for the rest of your life you're going to live by it. But the one you own and have that you have found, if you ever found something, all of a sudden it goes in your pocket and you got it. When I was a little boy, I used to go with my father. My father had an unusual hobby. I was just a little guy. I don't remember, maybe 6, 7 years old. And we would take an old, 1950 Ford Woody, whole family, pour into it, whole family, four of us, mom, dad, my older brother, and myself. And I really hated these times, but my dad was a gold prospector. Is that a strange hobby? And it wasn't such a strange hobby if you knew what Dad knew to look for and where. And we lived in the San Fernando Valley, and then we would drive, get in our car, Mom would pack a lunch, and we would drive out to a place called Saugus Newhall area. Today, it's all covered with homes. In those days, it was dirt roads driving out to those places. I remember the dirt coming in the windows and all that kind of stuff. And then we would hike through dirt roads until we found a stream. And I don't know, my dad told me, I don't know how true this is or untrue this is, but he would tell me that the first gold in California was found in Saugus Newhall area when a monk was passing through, pulled up wild onions. On the root of the onions were gold nuggets. And that was the first gold that was ever found in California, long before the California Gold Rush. I never checked it out. I'm sure all of you are going to jump on Google and Google it now and tell me afterwards if it's true or not. I could give a flip. My dad said it. I believed it. So don't tell me anything else. So there's the first gold that was found. Now, when my dad was starting out as a prospector, he had a pan, you know, and go like this with the water and teach me how to get all of the stuff settled down. And he actually is the most amazing thing in the world. He actually would pick out with a pair of tweezers. I still remember the vision of looking at gold nuggets in his pan. And he would pick them out, two or three of them, every afternoon that we were out there. Put them in a jar. I have absolutely no idea whatever happened to those. I don't know if Mama, when he died, she spent them. I don't know if my brother stole them. I don't know. I have no idea whatever happened to those. A whole little jar of gold nuggets, truly gold nuggets. But I remember something. God brought this to my remembrance today when I was meditating the word of the Lord. When my dad first started out, he went out and he purchased a little teeny gold piece of gold, and he purchased something that was called fool's gold. So you could see the difference between the two of them, because the area is filled with fool's gold and not real gold. And what it was is dad had something temporary, just something he bought for a few dollars of gold that was an example of real gold. And then when he found gold, it was his gold. And sometimes what we get from God when we ask for wisdom, he gives it to us. And that's the wisdom that's for temporary. And what I'm saying is that when you find wisdom, it becomes part of your life and now it's yours. And there's a big difference between having something that's yours that you can call on all the time, or just having something temporarily expressed to you for a momentary direction. And so when he makes this statement, he doesn't just say, ask God and get it liberally in this particular case. He says, a happy is the man who finds godly direction. And the word wisdom is a funny word. The word wisdom is a word that means God's insight for your future is what he's really talking about. That's the wisdom of God. In other words, God knows how to live on this planet, does he not? He created it all. And if you want to know how to live, how to be a good husband, how to be a good wife, how to be a good mother, how to be a good parent, how to be a good business person, how to make money, how to lose money, how to do it properly and make things happen, how to do everything so there's no issues in your life, you're going to have to find out God's insight on how to do life. And that's the wisdom. And you find that so it becomes part of you. But notice what he says. He goes on in the next part of the verse number, if you will. He says this, the man who gains understanding. So here's wisdom that is literally God's insight. And here is gaining understanding. How to apply the wisdom that God gave you. I can have the wisdom and never apply it. And you know people all the time that know the right things to do but don't do them. People who hear it and quote it but still don't do it. The understanding comes when you understand the ways that God has spoken to you, because that's what will make you happy. In other words, for the word happy is the word blessed. In other words, for the word happy is the word prosperous. So you find yourself in this place of getting a hold of the wisdom of God that becomes your way of doing life through his insight. And then you, guess what? Then you understand how to apply it. You have got something. It is sweet and beautiful. Can I just say something? Let me take you to one more verse because it's really kind of cool. I want to share this with you because this is the first time you see these two described. Verse 14. For her proceeds are better than the profit of silver, and her gain than fine gold. She is more precious than rubies, and all the things that you may desire and cannot compare with her. Length of days is in her right hand, and in her left hand riches and honor. Oh my goodness, wait a minute. The first time you see her is found in this verse 14. Her is described as wisdom and understanding. When you find wisdom and understand how to apply it and the reasons why you want to apply it, then all of a sudden, she, wisdom and understanding. Now you may not understand this, but anything beautiful in humanity is usually described as a she. I have a really cool book Debbie bought me. It's called Father's Day. For those of you that think that's weird, I gave a guy one time $250 million in business. That's a lot of money, over $250 million worth of business. And he said, what do you want for it? I said, I don't want anything. He said, no, I need to get you something. And he said these words to me. He says, let me buy you a helicopter. And I said, nah, I actually wanted the helicopter, but I asked Debbie, do you remember that, babe? And I asked Debbie, I said, Deb, can I have a helicopter? She said, no, you'd kill yourself. So I said to the guy, I said, okay, buy me a boat. So he bought me a boat, nice boat. And then we had a missionary come to church, you know? What was her name? Does anybody remember? Marilyn Skinner. Oh, I love Marilyn Skinner. She's not allowed in the church anymore. She ministered, and you don't know what happened, but I had this boat. It was free and clear. And I gave the boat to her, sold the boat, and we gave her $250,000. This church did. And I'm not saying that to brag. I'm saying that so you'll know that I planted seed. Okay, so a couple of years ago, Debbie buys me a boat on Father's Day because she knows I'm just crabby around the house. I don't have anything to do. I need to do something. She buys me a little boat. And I have this nice little sailboat. It's called Father's Day. Every time I refer to her, she's a girl, even though it's called Father's Day. It has double meanings. Number one, I get to go out in my boat and spend time with God, my father. Number two, Debbie bought it on Father's Day. But I always refer to the boat as her, she. Everybody that talks to me says, she is beautiful. She is sails fabulous. She is unbelievable. You get a young man that has bought a car, and it's a beautiful car for the first time, and it's a, she is gorgeous, isn't it? She is, anybody ever know what I'm talking about? She, it's like, she. Houses are named after women. Anything that's pretty, tough, soft, tender, precious is always not named after some burly haired goofball male, always after a woman. And you know, so here we find God doing the same thing. He refers to wisdom. Isn't this interesting? Understanding, verse 14, as for her proceeds. Proceeds are what you get from an investment. You know, you put your money in the bank, you get a couple percent back. You put your money in real estate, who knows what you get. It'll stay with it long enough, it'll come back. Proceeds are what comes in over a period of time, not all at once usually. And he says that her proceeds are better than the profit of silver, and her gain than fine gold. You know, fine gold didn't just describe gold. Pure gold is what he's talking about. That's the really expensive stuff. She is more precious than rubies. And listen to this one. And all the things that you may desire, in other words, she becomes more precious, cannot compare with her. Now listen to this. If you and I will simply find God's wisdom, listen to this, and understand how to apply it, and really apply it, not just hear it and not do it. Then all of a sudden in her, listen to this, right hand is length of day. In other words, there's some long, did you notice how length of day is more important to God on this planet as a righteous person than money? Because in her left hand, listen to what it says, in her left hand is riches and honor. very first thing he says is length of day. For me, I'm like Dr. Kobernick's mom. You know, I could say, well, if I'm here, fine. If I'm not, I can hardly wait to get out of here, be with Jesus, you know, length of day. But the longer I'm here, the more I get to serve him and become a living testimony of his grace and his goodness and his mercy. And I find myself at times realizing that length of day is very important, but it's not if I'm not happy. Happy is when you find out his way of doing things and you understand how to apply them. And then all of a sudden, that's more precious than any gold you'll ever have, any rubies. Not that you can't have them. God wants to prosper you. It's not that God wants to hold them back or keep them. So here comes the Word of God. It is so amazingly simple. And people, can I just say something? Oftentimes we are so stupid, by Tuesday we forget what you heard on Sunday. I mean, let's be honest with each other, you know? We're so, can I just say that in church? I guess if I had a white collar, I couldn't say it, but I don't have a white collar, man. I got white hair sticking out. So I guess I could say, we're so stupid, we forget what's preached on Sunday by Tuesday. And instead of getting godly wisdom and going to a place to get it and getting it as ours and then understanding how to apply it so that we can prosper in every area of our life and have long life and be happy while we're doing it. Come on, somebody. We don't do that. Because what do? We forget, go right back into the flesh, right back into the neighbor, right back into our own attitudes, our own ways, our own issues, instead of living his issues. But, if you acknowledge the Lord in all of his ways, if you acknowledge the Lord in all of his ways, if you acknowledge the Lord in all of your ways and my ways, if you acknowledge the Lord in all of your ways and my ways, the Bible says it's a promise. He'll direct your path. Stop. Draw the wisdom. It's temporary, but find out how you can hold it on and learn how to live that kind of a life. Saints of God, that's just a few verses out of the Book of Wisdom. If you got something from God, I believe you received something today. Give the Lord a great big praise. Will you do that? Ain't God good? Could I just ask you to remain seated? Let me make sure everybody's all right with God. We never liked to conclude a service without making and giving an opportunity for those of you that are not right with God to get right with God. Getting right with God is simple. It means you've given God all of your heart. It means you've given God all of your life. Now stop, think about it for just a moment. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, what God is after in every one of us, here's what it is. Did you know what it is? Here it is. All of your heart and all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. It's very important that you understand the depth of what I just said. It's all or nothing with God. I prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, Book of Revelation, Jesus said when he's coming, and you know when he's coming again, he says, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. In other words, lukewarm people who call themselves Christians are not going to make it, and they're going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus. Oh, my goodness. Did you just hear what I said? Lukewarm people. Lukewarm means a little up, a little down, a little token prayer. You know, you're not against God, but watch this. You're not wholehearted for God either. You probably go to church once in a while, but you haven't given God all of your heart. You haven't given God all of your life. You probably celebrate Christmas. You probably celebrate Easter. You don't have a problem even calling yourself a Christian, but that doesn't make you a real Christian because you call yourself a Christian. My goodness sakes alive. That doesn't make you a Christian. All through history, we see people that call themselves Christian do absolutely ungodly things to this world. They're not Christians at all. So you calling yourself a Christian doesn't make you a Christian. Here's the only way you become a Christian. Jesus comes to a guy by the name of Nicodemus in John 3rd chapter. He says, you must be born again. Born again, simply translated from the beginning of the Bible, the end of the Bible, means you've given God all of your heart, you've given God all of your life. Now stop and think about it. He said this to a guy by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus, what a funny name. Nicodemus, who is Nicodemus? John 3rd chapter. Nicodemus, man, he was a really cool dude. I mean, he probably knew more scripture than all of us. He probably quoted the scripture, debated the scripture, sang the scripture. My question to you is, how many of you have sung the scriptures? Come on. He fed the poor in his community. He was a leader in his church. He was like the pastor of his church, if you will. Oh my goodness. I would have thought Jesus would have come to Nicodemus and said, Nicodemus, you know what? You've really been a good guy and you've done all the right things, so you get to go to heaven. Heaven's waiting for you. They're going to be excited for you. Jesus doesn't say that to Nicodemus. Wouldn't you think he would have? I would have. He says, Nicodemus, you must be born again. Nicodemus like freaks out and says, well, I can't do that. I don't even know what that means. And then Jesus explains it. And really what he's saying is this. It's a spiritual thing of giving God all of your heart, giving God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship. And some of you tonight, you're here, but you haven't yet given God all of your heart. You haven't yet given God all of your life. You're living one foot in and one foot out. And guess what? He will vomit you from his mouth if you continue that way. So here you are tonight. Let's do this. Let's do it the right way. Let's get officially, without a doubt, born again, headed for heaven and denying your presence in hell. Because you're going to live for eternity somewhere, either with God or in hell. And somebody needs to love you enough, respect you enough to tell you the truth. That's the way it is. We're all going to live eternal lives somewhere, either in hell, according to the scripture, or in heaven with Jesus. And it's your call. Did you know it's your call? He gives you the free will choice. Someone said to me the other day, he says, well, Pastor, if Jesus really wants me, he'll get me. What more can he do than go to the cross and die for you? What more could he give? Planet? Gold, silver, diamonds, rubies, what could he give? Now it's your call, your choice, to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. So here we are. We're in this safe, friendly place. We have laughed, we've sung, heard the word of God. You were great listening to the word of God tonight. Oh my goodness, you were wonderful listening to the word of God. And I thank you for doing that, but that won't get you to heaven. Here's what gets you to heaven. When you give God willingly all of your heart and all of your life. And tonight is your night of salvation. You say, well, how do we do this? How do I give God all my heart, all my life? Let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So that's what Jesus said. So in a moment, I'm going to do this. I'm going to count three. I'm going to go like this. One, two, three. Bang! And you hear that sound? Bang! Your hand goes up. I see your hand go up. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is, I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. I want to give God all my heart, give God all my life. I want to be born again. And man, I'll see your hand. What did he say? If you confess me where? Before men. I'm a man, I'll see it. He says, but if you deny me, I'll deny you. Come on, don't sit there and do nothing. This is your day. This is your hour. This is your time. It's a divine appointment you have with God. And tonight is your night of salvation. I'm going to count to three. Who should raise their hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Come on, use the wisdom this moment that's on you. I'm going to count to three. If you've been running from God instead of to God, get ready to raise your hand. If you've never given God all of your heart, you know who you are, get ready to raise your hand. If you've never given God all of your life, get ready to raise your hand. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're not sure, you say, guy, man, I've been around the church all my life. I've always called myself a Christian. I've never been anything else but that. I went to catechism class when I was a child, or Sabbath school, or Sunday school class when I was a child. I know, but none of that will get you to heaven. It's about giving God all of your heart, giving God all of your life. So in a moment, I'll count to three, pop my hands together as I do. You get your hand up, let me see it, put it right back down. Is that okay? And then we'll pray with you. It's going to be wonderful. No weird stuff goes on, but you can get right with God in this safe, friendly place, and tonight is your night. I'm going to count to three right now. You know who you are that need to get your hand up. God's watching. You say, wait a minute, Pastor, if I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yep, you might be. Get over it. It's better to be embarrassed for a moment than to be in hell forever and ever 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 and ever. You don't get to have a second chance come around again, you know, like born as a frog and come back. Whoever thought of such stupid stuff as that? Oh my goodness, come on. Listen to me. There's no, once you're there, you're there. And you don't want to get there, and you know it, and it takes just a moment. You say, so Pastor, I'm embarrassed. Yeah, so what? Isn't it better to be embarrassed in this place than to be in hell forever? Because you're more afraid of what people think instead of what God sees. Come on, tonight is your night of salvation. I'm counting. Here it is. 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's 1. Thank you. There's 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Thank you. Back over here. God bless you. Anybody in the family rooms? I can see you in the family rooms. Anybody else? There's 8 wise people already. Come on. There's 9. Thank you. God bless you. I see you. There's another one. Thank you. Thank you. There's another one. Thank you. God bless you. Good to see you. Anybody else? Real quick. I want to pray for the sick too tonight. So I want you, if you're thinking about raising your hand, do it. Anybody else? There's 9 wise people. Anybody else? Oh, stretching doesn't count. I won't count you if you're stretching. There's another one. Thank you. God bless you. Good to see you. All right, well, thank God for 8, 9, 10, something like that. I lost count, but God knows who you are. Here's what I want you to do. All 8, 9, or 10 of you, once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend, even in the family room, if you raised your hand. God knows it's hard to get your kids out. Get your kids, get all your stuff, bring your coat, Bible. You sit next to somebody, say, come on, friend, I'll go with you. If you need to go, just nudge them and say, come on, if you need to go, I'll go with you. And then get in the aisle, meet me right here in front. So real quick, could everybody just stand up for a moment? And let's give them a hand as they come. If you raised your hand, you're serious about God, get out of your seat and come right now. Come on.
Jesus, I believe in you.
Come on, come on, come on.
Jesus,
if you raised your hand, you're serious about God, you come right now. Come on. Oh, they're coming. Give them a hand as they come.
You're the reason that I am here. Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason
that I am here. Ain't God good? You ought to give the Lord a big shout for that. Wow, there's more than 10 of you up here. Hey, real quick, I want to point out, this is Dr. Becker. We call him Dr. B, like A, B, C, B. Not the C nor the A, Dr. B. Hi, Dr. B. And see the nice smile he has on his face? You need to put a nice smile on your face. He's a good guy. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You're going to end up being born again, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. You're not going to die and go to a morgue. You're going to go be with Jesus when that time comes. That's a good thing. And you know, the Bible says that his truth will set you free. You're going to get free. Oh, thank God, tonight is your night of salvation. Make a left turn, follow Dr. B right over that way. Come on. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.